Fluoride science is corporate science. Fluoride science is DDT science. It's asbestos science. It's tobacco science. It's a racket.
In July of 2004, Christopher Bryson sat down and discussed the findings of his new book, The Fluoride Deception, with Paul Connett of the Fluoride Action Network. The Fluoride Deception was published by Seven Stories Press in May of 2004. The book is based on nearly 10 years of research by Bryson, an award-winning journalist and former producer at the BBC. In this interview, we asked Bryson to introduce us to some of the important individuals and institutions which have played a role in shaping public policy on the toxicity of fluoride and the purported safety of the controversial water fluoridation program.
In 1993, I was working at Rockefeller Center in New York as a radio producer for the BBC. And I got a call from London. There was a local water fluoridation battle in the north of England, in Leeds. And the producers, it was a daytime radio show, You and Yours was the name of the program. And the producer said, Chris, what do you know about fluoride? What do the Yanks think about fluoride? Is there an American angle? And it was a very, you know, a familiar request to me. Is there an American angle to the story? And I said, look, I don't know fluoride from a hole in the wall. I have no idea about fluoride, but let me make a few phone calls and see if I can't help you out. And my first call was to Ralph Nader in Washington. And I'm not sure why I called Ralph Nader, but look, it was a consumer issue. And Mr. Consumer, Ralph Nader, I thought, let's give him a call. And I got through, and he said, look, I don't know a great deal about water fluoridation, but I've never had terribly good feelings about it. Here are the names of a couple of scientists you ought to speak with. And he gave me the names of Dr. William Hersey, who then and now is a chemist at the Environmental Protection Agency, and Dr. Robert J. Carton. Bob Carton had been with EPA, but at that time was then over at the U.S. Army. And I went down to Washington and met with Dr. Hersey and Dr. Carton, and they explained to me that the safety standards for water fluoridation in this country are based on fraudulent science. Fluoride defenders will say there's two stories. There's the industrial story and there's the dental story, and ne'er the twain shall meet. It's not true. The stories are braided very tightly and very profoundly, and they're braided from the beginning. The very first suggestion that fluoride be added to public water supplies was made by a researcher, Gerald Cox, at the Mellon Institute in Pittsburgh. Cox became interested in fluoride because of the suggestion of Francis Freire. That's the letter I uncovered. Francis Freire is the director of the aluminum laboratory for the Aluminum Company of America. He is very concerned about fluoride pollution around aluminum plants. He's very concerned about what the fluoride is doing to the workers inside these aluminum plants. But his suggestion to Gerald Cox is to look at fluoride's dental effects. And it's upon the basis of that suggestion that Gerald Cox makes his proposal to add fluoride to public water supplies. Right at the very source of the stream, you find the aluminum industry. Cox's suggestion that we add fluoride to public water supplies needs to be understood for who was saying it and where he was saying it and what the track record of the Mellon Institute was. The Mellon Institute was a leading defender of asbestos for the asbestos industry. You know, today, industry are facing a tidal wave, a crippling tidal wave of lawsuits from people who have had their health damaged, who've been killed by asbestos. Well, for generations, the Mellon Institute produced research that said that mesothelioma was caused by something other than asbestos. That's how you have to understand the fluoride issue. Industry was concerned about fluoride pollution and about lawsuits of a similar magnitude for fluoride pollution, so it's no coincidence that the Mellon Institute makes the first suggestion that fluoride be added to public water supplies. It's quite astonishing, Paul, the degree to which environmentalists have not been educated about fluoride. You know, and you know, I'm a reporter. I'm not a scientist or a doctor. You know, I'm quoting documents. I'm citing lawsuits when I refer to fluoride as a major industrial air pollutant. In fact, the leading air pollutant in the aftermath of the Cold War. Those are not my words. That's not my opinion. That's a quantitative assessment by industry experts of the scale of the lawsuits they were facing. You know, the most notorious air pollution disaster in U.S. history was the Halloween air pollution incident in Donora, Pennsylvania, a mill town south of Pittsburgh, where a couple of dozen people and several thousand were injured because of effluents coming from a U.S. steel plant, which were trapped by a temperature inversion. In the aftermath of those deaths, a researcher, Philip Stadler, a chemist, Philip Stadler, investigated. He did blood analysis, and he measured high levels of fluoride in the blood of some of the injured and the deceased. He published that data along with data which found high levels of fluoride in vegetation and a lot of other circumstantial evidence indicating fluoride poisoning. Sadler published his research in Chemical and Engineering News, but the Public Health Service came in and said that fluoride wasn't responsible. It was a mixture of air pollutants and bad weather that had caused the disaster. Well, I uncovered a memo, Paul, a memo from the Aluminum Company of America, in which they had secretly gotten blood from one of the deceased. And their measurements were almost exactly the same measurements that Philip Sadler found. Laundering fluoride's role in the Donora pollution incident is really emblematic for what has happened for the last half century, and an accounting for why environmentalists don't know their own history. Donora jump-started the environmental movement, but environmentalists don't know that Donora was almost certainly caused by fluoride. The book looks very hard at the role of a key scientist, Dr. Harold Hodge, in the fluoride debate. Dr. Harold Hodge, for most of the Cold War, was the leading scientific defender of the safety of low doses of fluoride and the beneficial effects of water fluoridation.
Dr. Harold Hodge, a distinguished toxicologist on the Rochester team, has carefully investigated the safety of fluoridation.
Well, to put it very simply, fluoride is safe at one part per million.
No scientist's word was trusted more by the health establishment than Dr. Harold Hodge when it came to fluoride. He was a very senior figure and operated at the highest levels for almost all of his scientific career.
This brings us back to the fundamental point. Fluoride is safe, and I think I can say in conclusion that there is no health hazard that justifies postponing water fluoridation.